interventional guidance. I thought everyone are in gathering at Acropolis, but I'm very pleased that everyone is coming here today. So my name is Ken Masamune, Tokyo Women's Medical University from Japan, and I'm a co-chair with...
My name is Orchun Göksel, from ETH Zurich, Switzerland. And I would like to announce the first talk of the session, which is 3D near... Is the first speaker here? 3D near-infrared and ultrasound imaging of peripheral blood vessels for real-time localization and needle guidance. The work is from Rutgers University. Please.
Okay. Good afternoon. Thank you for your time. And I'm happy to be able to talk about this project, developing an imaging system for vascular access. The title is a little bit different than the title of the paper, because we thought it would be... How does this work? Just this.
I think we have some brief technical problems.
Oh, that's
okay. Now it's going.
Okay. So the title is a little bit different than the title of the paper. We thought it'd be interesting to talk about some of the robotics work that we've been doing that's very closely related. And so the project is a collaboration between Rutgers University, New Jersey, the Robert Wood Johnson Hospital, New Jersey, as well as the Massachusetts General and the Riverside Research Institute, which is in New York. And the question we're asking is actually very simple. It's how can we enable clinicians to more reliably access the bloodstream so they can do what they need to do? And so if you walk into the doctor's office or into the outpatient clinic, one of the most common things that happens is that you'll need to get your blood drawn and tested. Alternatively, in the ED, in the OR, in the cath lab, it's very common to need to have a peripheral venous or arterial catheter placed so that they can deliver drugs or do other interventions. These procedures are performed millions of times each day in the United States, billions of times each year overall, and they represent the single most common medical routine and are the first step in the vast majority of clinical visits. And so the first impression may be that these procedures shouldn't be a critical problem for practitioners since they are performed so commonly. However, in reality, errors build up and are actually quite prevalent. And these errors have actually caused the diagnostic testing industry to automate much of the analytic process that occurs downstream. And similarly, in the OR and other interventional situations, technological advancements have allowed complications to become reduced. However, it's been shown through many studies that the vast majority of complications actually occurs upstream during the access itself. And as a result, vascular access is not only the number one cause, number one procedure, but it's also the number one cause of injury to the patients. It also happens to be the number one cause of injury to the clinicians because they're working with sharps very frequently. In certain demographic populations, for example, in pediatric patients and elderly and chronically ill, obese people, there's a high difficulty of vascular access. In many of these situations, patients are already on anticoagulant or antiplatelet, and so the risk of bleeding increases even more. And in total, these costs lead to very large exorbitant costs to the healthcare system. And so our thought was that maybe it's possible to develop some tools, maybe an imaging tool to be able to assist clinicians, or even a device that can perform these procedures by itself. And if this is possible, then maybe it's able that we could deliver very tangible clinical benefits to hospitals, labs, and other settings. And so the device shown here is one system that we've developed, and it incorporates two modes of imaging. So the first is a 3D multispectral near-IR imaging modality. The second is a standard 2D ultrasound, and then we've also integrated it with robotics. And so the Mackay paper focuses on the imaging component, but I'll also talk about the robotics toward the end. And so it's, we like to emphasize that it can be used as a standalone imaging tool, so it's not only useful when it's integrated with a robotic device. And the basic workflow is that the near-IR component provides a 3D map of the vasculature over your arm, your leg, with increased contrast and penetration depth compared to human eyesight. And then a selected access site is then targeted and imaged locally by the ultrasound. And so in order to automate these procedures to either assist the clinician or be able to perform it robotically, we've developed a fairly extensive GPU-enabled image analysis pipeline, the basics of which include vessel segmentation both in the IR image and in the ultrasound image, both dense and feature-based stereo, passive stereo. We've also developed active structured light stereo for 3D reconstruction in real time, vessel structure recognition for the labeling task, and then the needle tracking functionality in the ultrasound. And to evaluate the effectiveness of the imaging approach, we compared the results of the imaging system to standard clinical assessment in 101 patients recruited at Rutgers across a broad demographic range of age, BMI, ethnicity, and so on. And we found that using the near-IR component, we were able to significantly improve visibility based on this is a path length metric shown in the top row. And we're also able to detect a significantly increased percentage of the major cannulation sites, the median cubital, brachial vein, cephalic vein, and so on, compared to standard assessment. Using 3D IR, we were able to detect 70% of otherwise invisible peripheral vessels. And we had the remainder of the study is to evaluate the added benefits of the ultrasound, which we don't expect to, it definitely wouldn't decrease the results, and it may provide added benefit because of the lesser dependence on demographic parameters, as well as the ability to provide depth resolution, motion compensation, and needle tracking using the ultrasound. And so in addition to developing the system as a standalone tool, like I said earlier, we've also integrated with several robotic systems. And here I show three. These are in increasing levels of autonomous functionality. And the reason we have more than one system is because different systems are designed for different clinical scenarios, different hospital settings, and they also have different costs and different functionalities overall. We've evaluated both the imaging component and the robotic system in a very large preclinical phantom study where we developed customized phantoms that are tailorable to simulate the broad spectrum of physiological and demographic conditions that we see in the human population. The phantoms mimic the acoustic, optical, mechanical properties of human skin and vessels. And we use statistical experimental design approaches to be able to evaluate a very large experimental space in a feasible amount of trials. And we found that both the manual cannulation guided by the imaging system as well as the automated methods both improved success rates compared to the standard of care, which is either manual palpation or standard ultrasound guided manual cannulations. And that these improvements were particularly noticeable in the most difficult conditions that we simulated. And again, so this shows that these improvements occurred for different clinically relevant metrics, including first stick accuracy, the average number of needle attempts, as well as the completion time. We also evaluated these systems in animals. So here we show one version of the device performing a tail vein cannulation in a Sprague Dolly rat. And we compared the device to manual tail vein sampling and saw significant improvements. We also found, interestingly, that we could get similar results if we turned off the ultrasound probe. And this is in contrast with our human imaging studies as well as with our phantom studies, in which model human physiological parameters. In the animals, we're able to use the IR alone to gain sufficiently improved results. And based on this, we've been developing a low-cost, miniaturized system dedicated for these kind of procedures, which has garnered interest as a tool for preclinical research within the research community. And so finally, we are conducting feasibility studies in patients. So we have one study ongoing at Rutgers. We're also initiating studies elsewhere where we want to evaluate the safety and efficacy of the system. So initial studies will be done in healthy adults, but upon successful completion of these studies, we'd like to do follow-up studies in difficult patient populations, as well as to assess effectiveness in these targeted hospital settings like the OR, like the cath lab, and so on. To date, we've talked to a number of the major diagnostic laboratories, LabCorp, Quest, these kind of laboratories in the United States, as well as major metropolitan hospitals in the United States, to try to identify how we can fit within the existing clinical workflow. And so with that, I'd like to thank all of the collaborators on the project, as well as our funding sources, and Mackay for allowing us to, giving us the opportunity to share this work. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. Now the talk is open for questions. Just to get the question started, I have one. Regarding the elasticity values that you tested, it seems like I was wondering actually how much the vessels will deform as the needles are inserting. Do they deform at all? And if they do, do you track these in real time and compensate for them?
Right, so the deformation is one of the major reasons it can be a challenge. In normal circumstances. So that's one of the critical parameters that we modeled, and the system works in real time. So the imaging will guide the robotics so that it can do motion compensation at around 40 frames per second based off the images to adjust for deformation of the vessels. Yeah, that was probably the most important parameter.
So you are currently tracking and deforming.
Right, right. It was the major source of difficulty, actually. So.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
I'm just wondering, maybe not related to the image guided. I'm wondering, the main challenge of the system is mainly on the robotic system or on the image guided intervention?
Probably 50-50. So the main challenge is probably the computer vision component. To make it work robustly and in real time, the margins are small. So we want to get, for example, if you want 98% accuracy, then you need very robust computer vision. And so that, in conjunction with robotics, which are reliable enough, which can be calibrated in a hospital setting, which don't break down over time, and which are cost effective, I think those together are the major challenges of this technology.
I've seen some of this before. This is really cool. One question that came to my mind is, as you're, in addition to locating the vessel laterally and you're inserting, how do you prevent yourself from going beyond into the lumen and out of the lumen? And what size vessel are you comfortably able always to stick?
So to answer the first part, I didn't get time to talk about it, but there's several safety mechanisms to prevent overshoot.
Uh-huh.
The first is the ultrasound image alone, and the second is we have a very low-cost uniaxial force sensor attached to the base of the needle.
Yeah, that's right.
And then we apply, for example, we have a Kalman filter that integrates both, and then based on that we have a lot of safety.
And in terms of the targeting,
the second question, so the rat tail veins were 0.7 millimeters. So it's actually small. So the average neonatal vessel is around 1 millimeter.
Okay.
And our goal is to be able to cannulate those. In adults, we're targeting 2 millimeters, but these are very small vessels.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think we can move on to the next talk. Let's thank the speaker again.
Okay, so the next talk is, the title is The Endoscope Program. A 3D model reconstructed from endoscopic video frames. So please start your presentation.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Qingyu Zhang from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Today, I'm going to talk about a pipeline for reconstructing a 3D surface model, which we call endoscopogram from an endoscopic movie. So first, to give some background, endoscopy is an in-body examination procedure that enables direct visualization of tissue texture, including the tumor spread. For example, here is an endoscopic movie of the pharynx, and this structure here is called the epiglottis, and you can see the vocal cord down there, and also you can clearly see a tumor on the surface. We believe this endoscopic information about the tumor is really important for radiation treatment planning. So currently in the planning stage, physicians will heavily rely on image modalities like CT to localize the tumor. But sometimes due to its low spatial and intensity resolution, it's very hard to find the tumor in the CT image. So it would be really beneficial to somehow transfer the tumor information from the video into the 3D CT space. One way to do this is that first we can reconstruct a 3D surface model from the video, which we call endoscopogram. And next, we can have a CT segmentation surface from the 3D CT scan. And finally, we carry out a surface registration between the two surfaces, and the end result of this is a transformation that can carry the tumor information from the video into the 3D CT space. And this paper particularly talks about this reconstruction task. And endoscopy reconstruction has been studied for different situations, and it's been a challenging problem. Particularly in our problem, we have to deal with the non-rigid tissue motion that is happening during endoscopy time. And moreover, we have to carefully handle the occluded regions that are not seen by the camera. And finally, we have to deal with the illuminance change across different frames in the texture synthesis procedure. In this talk, I hope to at least address several of these challenges. So there are three major steps in this pipeline. First, the frame-by-frame reconstruction produces for each frame its own individual single-frame reconstruction. And next, the geometry fusion step takes all these individual single-frame reconstructions and fuse them together into a single piece of geometry. And finally, we texture this surface by using the raw frames. And the end result is this endoscopogram, which is a 3D surface. The major contribution of this paper is to introduce a novel geometry fusion algorithm. But before talking about this, I would like to also say a couple of words about the other two steps. So first, the frame-by-frame reconstruction uses a shape-form motion shading algorithm, which is also developed in our group previously. This is basically an effective combination between structure from motion and shape from shading. On the one hand, structure from motion can estimate a sparse set of 3D point positions. And by using those 3D points as global constraint, shape from shading, on the other hand, can estimate local surface geometry and also the light reflectance model. So the end result of this step is that we can produce for each frame its own individual single frame reconstruction. And in the final texture matching stage, the challenge comes from the fact that a point on the final endoscopogram may be observed from multiple images. So we have to deal with different illuminance across different frames to avoid the stitching artifact in the texture synthesis procedure. So we formulate this problem as a labeling problem and use a Markov random field-based method to solve it. Okay, so now let's come to the geometry fusion step, which is the core of this paper. So let me remind you that the goal of geometry fusion is to take all the single frame reconstructions and stitch them together into a bigger complete surface. Before going into details, I'd like to show you with this 1D example what kind of situation we're facing here. So here, the three different curves indicate three different single-frame reconstructions. And notice that they are only partially overlapping with each other because the camera viewport is constantly changing during the endoscopy time. And meanwhile, we also have tissue motion causing non-rigid deformations across these single-frame reconstructions. And finally, we also have to deal with missing data represented as holes caused by occlusion, basically the regions that are not seen by the camera. In the end, we would like to have a group-wise surface registration method that can register all these individual surfaces into a single surface. So talking about the group-wise surface registration method, actually there are several work has been done in this area. But most of them will require a template surface or a mean surface available beforehand. But in our situation, when the data is only partially overlapping, potentially with missing data and topology change, having a template beforehand is very difficult. So we would like to do this group-wise surface registration in a template-free way. We develop our method based on the notion of attraction force in the daemon space method. So the idea is that when you have two objects, we can somehow construct a set of virtual attraction forces between the two objects so that the deformable object can be gradually attracted to the static object. So now when you have two surfaces, what you can do is that you can find a set of corresponding landmarks between the two surfaces by either doing some kind of geometric feature matching between the two surfaces or some image feature matching between the two underlying texture images. So when you have this set of corresponding landmarks between the two surfaces, we can use them as the virtual attraction forces between the two surfaces to guide the deformation from this surface to that surface. So now we can minimize such a energy function in this form. This is basically similar to a lot other registration frameworks where you have two terms. The first term, the data similarity term, basically says, well, the deformation has to coincide with your force vectors. And the second term is just a regularization. Notice that we call F here the attraction force vectors, but that's just for conceptual purpose. It's not in any sense physical. So they are actually just vectors connecting corresponding landmarks, correspondences between the two surfaces. Okay, so we actually have shown in previous work that the advantage of doing this comes from the fact that even though the two surfaces are only partially overlapping, the set of corresponding landmarks can still be robustly detected by feature matching because the features are computed by using local information. So the conclusion is that this method is quite robust against partially overlapping data and missing data and topology change. So now we extend this idea into the group-wise situation. So the idea is that now when you have two N surfaces, then for each surface, it can be simultaneously attracted to all the other N minus one surfaces. For example, here surface I can be attracted to surface J and also simultaneously attracted to surface K. And we can actually construct an overall attraction, which is something like the average of the two individual attractions. So this part is basically to the analog of the embodied problem where you can summarize the gravity forces from an object to all the other N minus one objects into a total single gravity force. So you can do this for every surface and then evolve them a little bit according to the current attraction. And next you can recompute the attraction forces among them and iterate. So basically in doing this, all the surfaces will be deformed into an implicit target mean position step by step iteratively in an Euler fashion. So to be more specific, if you have a point X on surface I and have N minus one correspondences in the other N minus one surfaces, the way to construct this overall attraction force in our work is just a weighted average based on feature matching scores. And after computing this overall attraction forces, we can solve for the deformation of surface I by solving the exact same optimization as we did before, except that the force attraction force applied on surface I is replaced by this overall attraction force. However, there might be a tricky problem you might want to pay attention to in doing this. That is, without an explicit target mean position, we might overshoot the deformation with very, very large initial forces. So in our experiment, we found that we can partially solve this problem by controlling the amount of regularization in this formulation. So what we're gonna do is that we will first start off with a very large regularization term because usually a large regularization will produce relatively small deformation. So we will start off with this relatively large deformation, regularization, and gradually tune down the regularization term in this iteration steps. Okay, having talking about these techniques, let's come to some results. So we first validate our group-wise surface registration with some synthetic data. We have CT segmentation surfaces from 6 patients, and for each patient, we apply synthetic deformations, in this case, the swallowing motion of the throat to each of those CT segmentation surfaces. And we also manually created missing data situation, partially overlapping data situation, or even some topology change situation. And we want to test our registration framework to see whether we can register back all those deformed surfaces. And we compare our method with another spectrograph matching-based method, and the result shows that our method can produce quite competitive result in this situation. And finally, I would like to show you several of our final endoscopic gram reconstruction from endoscopic movies. Note that the left two cases are from real patient movie, and the right case is actually a static physical phantom. So this is all I have for today, and I'm ready to take questions.
Thank you for your nice presentation. And now it's open for discussion. Yes, please.
So I have, thanks for the talk. I have a question. First is, what kind of a structure from motion methods you use to reconstruct the 3D surface before the data fusion? And the second question is, when you mentioned about the partial overlapping for the data, and also some of missing data, I want to know that the ratio of the missing data or the ratio of the partial overlapping between the different data you want to fuse for the final 3D reconstructed surface.
Okay. So for the first question, so before the geometric fusion, we use a combination of structure from motion and shape from shading. So the structure from motion is just a rigid standard structure from motion that produces a set of sparse 3D point positions. And actually, it's the shape from shading that can estimate the dense depth map, dense reconstruction. Basically, it's a combination. And the second question, I can't give you an exact number. From our experiment, the missing patches falls in the range roughly from 20% to 30%, but the partially overlapping situation varies from case to case. When you have camera motion very large in the sequence, you may observe very large non-overlapping cases, but it varies from case to case.
So the structure is not, it's a rigid structure from motion, it's not a non-rigid structure from motion, right?
Right, in the current state we are using rigid.
Okay, mm-hmm. Thanks.
Can I have a short question?
So I think it's a neat approach to a difficult problem, but I was very curious, following up on the structure from motion question, isn't the reconstruction that you're getting at the beginning up to scale? So how are you dealing with the fact that you have an unknown scale and you're getting metric results at the end?
You're talking about the scale of the data?
The scale of the reconstruction. So structure from motion only produces a reconstruction up to an unknown scale factor.
Yes. So that scale problem actually is going to be a problem when we try to register this endoscopic reconstruction to the CT. But you're right, we don't have a sense of scale in the current stage. Mm-hmm.
So how are you reporting millimeters of error then? Is that your...
Because that is synthetic data applied on CT segmentation meshes, and the CT has a scale notion.
Okay. All right, thank you.
That's a very quick question. Yeah.
Just if you can briefly comment on how would you evaluate the usability from a surgeon's point of view?
We're carrying on a clinical study with the doctors, we are collecting more and more data and try to use this pipeline to produce endoscopic reconstruction and do this tumor information transformation to the CT space and try to ask the doctors back, if you see this information beforehand, would you change your decisions in your radiation treatment plan? But this is ongoing clinical study right now.
Okay, so thank you very much for your presentation. So we move to the next.
So next talk is titled Structure-Aware Rank 1 Tensor Approximation for Curvilinear Structure Tracking Using Learned Hierarchical Features, a collaboration between Temple University and Siemens Healthcare, presented by Yefeng Zeng.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. This work of Professor Haibin Ding and his student from Temple University, unfortunately, they won't be able to attend this conference, so I have to present this work. I will try my best. Yeah. Here we want to track a curvilinear structure in fluoroscopic images. Curvilinear structure can be castor, guide wire, or physical structure, or any some other structures. But this is still a hard problem because a lot of variations in appearance because of low feasibility, because doctors want to reduce the dose of the image as much as possible, so the feasibility of an object sometimes pretty difficult to see. And the motion is 3D, and they project onto 2D, so this creates some actual ambiguity. So this is our formulation problem. We are given a whole sequence of the X-ray images, and the user needs to annotate the target, and the structure, and they want to annotate, they want to track on the first frame. Then we take the whole sequence to get the global optimum solution. So this is different to online tracking. On online tracking, you can only take the current frame and all previous frame. But here, we take a whole sequence. That means we can look forward into the future. The output, of course, is the trajectory of the landmarks on the curve of the whole sequence. This is a brief overview of our work, of our method, given the sequence. We train a detector based on user annotation on the first frame, then we detect all the candidate of the structure on all following frames. Now we get the annotated structure candidate, we consider all possible trajectory. So we will organize the trajectory into a tensor, then each element in tensor actually corresponds to one trajectory, one possible trajectory. The value of this element is the goodness or affinity of this trajectory. And no one found the optimal trajectory for all landmarks. There where the affinity, some affinity is maximized, but this is a incomplete hard problem. Based on Haibin's CPR paper, they came up a solution called rank one tensor decomposition to solve this problem. I will come back to this later. But for this application, we want to track a curve. So all landmarks are connected to form a curvilinear structure. So we have some additional constraint to improve the robustness. For example, the ordinate of a point should be preserved after motion. First, the candidate detection. Previously, random force based detector is used to detect candidate. Here, we replace it with a convolution neural network for an input. We call about 28 by 28 image patch to convolution, max pooling, convolution, max pooling, reduce to a one-dimensional feature factor. Then we train a classifier to give us a probability map. We can do some further processing for the filtering or thinning. Here's a comparison with random force-based approach. This grand tooth, this probability map created by random force-based detector, this is our new detector. You see, the probability map is my cleaner. Use new detector. For tracking, our first party far away from the position on the previous frame can be ignored. So basically, we only focus on the green dot here. But if you only consider green dot, our new result is also much cleaner. So next step is the tracking. So first, let's take a look at a simple problem. We only consider one frame in the future. So assume for each frame, we have four candidates. We want to find the optimum assignment or optimum association of this candidate. So we can define some similarity measurement. We can form this 2D matrix and use Hungarian axiom to find the optimal solution. In reality, we may have false positive, false negative. So the total number of candidates on each frame may be different. But this can be solved by adding a dummy point, which means add an actual column, actual node in the affinity matrix, and can still be solved by Hungarian axiom. So here we assume, in the future, we assume that on each candidate, we have same number, on each frame, we have same number of candidates. Then the next step is we want to find the optimal trajectory that the sum of affinities maximized. So the trajectory will take a value 1 if we pick this one, otherwise it's 0. And all the trajectory needs satisfying the one-to-one correspondence. So how to define the affinity tensor? It basically is an open framework. You can use any kind of method. Here, our affinity tensor have two components. One component based on appearance, similarity of appearance. So each candidate will call up a patch sent on this candidate, then calculate the intended histogram, and then measure the similarity between histogram. Then we take the product of the similarity measure between labeling frames and the similarity of the whole trajectory. The next term is purely based on the trajectory. We want the trajectory to be smooth with low curvature. We don't want it to jump around. So we borrow some ideas for active contours to measure the continuity, measure the curvature. So basically, we want a smooth mesh. Minimize the cost of here. And the trajectory can be represented either as a z function or as an x function. Here, x actually represents the matching between two labeling frames. We pick the trajectory, means we pick the matching, all the corresponding matching between labeling frames. So we can represent this z function as an x function. Here, x function is still an integer, take a value 0 or 1. They still satisfy this one-to-one assignment constraint. So if you represent like this, then in their CPR paper, they show that the affinity, the optimal solution can be approximated by a rank one decomposition of this affinity tensor. So basically, if we can approximate the tensor as a product of k one-dimensional factors, then each factor represents the matching between two labeling frames. So for example, this tensor represents matching between frame 0 and frame 1. And then in the next step, I forgot to mention one thing. Here in their work, they need to relax the constraint. Instead of taking integer by 0 or 1, they allow you to take a real file from 0 to 1. Therefore, you can do decomposition. So in the end, you get ambiguous matching, but you can finalize the matching by running Hungarian axiom for each labeling frames. So this is the work based on the CPR paper. But in this work, we can enforce some further constraint. For example, all the landmarks should be connected to form a curvilinear structure. So we don't want to allow the ordering of a point to be changed after the motion. So in this kind of motion shown by the pink arrow are not good. How to measure how well this ordering is preserved. We take a simple idea. For two labeling points, we can use this blue factor to measure the relative position of these two landmark points. So after motion, you still have the relative orientation. Then you take the angle distance between these two factors. So we want to minimize this distance. Another component is that labeling landmarks should have similar trajectory. So for example, this trajectory is more similar to this, then the trajectory should be right. So similarly, we take an angle distance between the trajectory of two labeling landmarks as a measurement. So we can put them together. So the first term is still the affinity tensor-based formulation. The second term, we try to enforce the curvilinear structure prior. these are two components, as I said, as I showed you before. And this object function is still subject to constraint of a one-to-one correspondence and binary matching constraint. Yeah, let's form the method. Let's take a look of the result. We have multiple sequences, so we put them together. This is an original sequence. This is the user annotation. This is the tracking result of the proposed method. We compare with several different methods, for example, use the registration-based approach, or just consider two frames, then do graph matching between two frames, or use an original tensor-based approach, but without the constraints of a curvilinear, over the curvilinear constraint. We can take a closer look over the tracking results. So without the curvilinear constraint, even the motion is too big. Sometimes we just lost the tracking over these landmarks. Then we can see in the curve after the tracking can be pretty cursive. And sometimes it may form a loop in the curve. But if we enforce this curvilinear constraint, the lost motion can be compensated or can be recovered from the neighboring landmarks. So we can still preserve this curvilinear shape quite well. This is another example. Here, a more quantitative evaluation. As I said, we have two application scenarios. One is for different intervention, the other for cardiac intervention. For different intervention, we have 6 sequences. For cardiac intervention, we have 11 sequences. We compare with registration-based approach, two-frame graph matching, general tensor-based approach, and in these two methods, random force is used to detect candidate. To have fair comparison, we also enhance them using the convolution neural network-based detector. You can see clearly in the convolutional neural network-based detector improving the tracking result. Okay, here all the numbers match the distance between annotated curve and then the track curve, represented in millimeters. If we first enforce the curvilinear shape prior compared to this general tensor-based approach, we can say we improve the accuracy on most of the sequences. So on average, we observe quite some good improvement. Okay, here are conclusions. We propose a new method to track curvilinear structures in photoscopic images. And we use the convolutional neural network to detect candidate. It is more robust than the random force-based detector. Information from multiple sequence frames is leveraged use a tensor-based tracking framework. And in this work, we first enforce curvilinear shape prior during tracking to improve robustness. Thank you. That's all.
So the talk is open for questions. So maybe I start the first question. I believe so. You are using a curvilinear assumption for vessels as well. I'm wondering how valid is this assumption for vessels all the time. For example, how does your algorithm handle bifurcations at the vessels?
Can you repeat again?
Bifurcation, so when actually the vessel forks or combines, how does it hang?
Yes, here we just track one curve. So we didn't track the whole curve, the tree structure of a vessel. So so we don't have the problem of bifurcations or other kind of issues.
Okay, thank you. So any other questions?
I don't know if you're familiar with T-snakes. So probably it's archaeology for you, but 10 years ago, 15 years, my advisor, Trezopoulos, developed these methods. And based on elasticity, you could do all this stuff that you saw. And you don't have to use any priors because the elasticity will, you know, serves as a constraint. And also can do bifurcations. Have you tried bifurcations?
No, tried yet. I think the advantage of this work is that we can use multiple frames instead of just one frame. Basically, we can use the whole sequence, ideally. To get the global object solution.
With these methods, you don't have to know anything. Okay, maybe you should read them.
Any other questions? If not, let's thank the speaker for the next. So, the next presenter, Adrien Desjardins, I hope I pronounced correctly, from University College London, will be presenting 3D ultrasonic needle tracking with a 1.5D transducer array for guidance of fetal interventions. Please.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. My name is Adrien Desjardins. I'm from the University College London, and today I'll be presenting on behalf of Wenfeng Xia, who's the first author on this study. And here we address a problem that is found in many clinical contexts in which ultrasound imaging is used to guide a medical device, such as a needle or a catheter, into the body. And the problem is specifically to identify where the needle or catheter is in relation to the ultrasound imaging plane. This particular study was situated in the context of fetal medicine. So let's take a look at a procedure at UCL Hospital. This procedure is called amniocentesis, and here you can see a pregnant woman, and you can see an ultrasound imaging probe being held by a clinician in one hand, and in the other hand of the clinician, there is a needle. It's hard to see it right here. And the idea is to insert that needle into the amniotic fluid, which is the region immediately surrounding the fetus. And the objective of the procedure is to extract a small volume of fluid for analysis. So let's see how that goes. So you can see the needle puncturing the skin and then being inserted inside. And so I guess the question that we have on our minds is, where is the needle tip now? And for this, we have ultrasound imaging, and ultrasound provides beautiful anatomical pictures. We can see in particular the fetal head, and this is the hyperechoic circular region on the left here. But I think the question remains, where is the needle tip? And what's happened here is that the needle has not yet intersected with the ultrasound image. And what the clinician is about to do next is to manipulate the probe at the surface. And these manipulations involve rotating and laterally translating the probe to try to identify the needle tip. So let's see that. And what you can see is the anatomical view changing slightly, and then ultimately a bright spot emerges, and that is the needle tip. And I think, as you can appreciate, in situations where the needle tip is in complex, dense tissue, when the needle is steeply angled, when the needle tip is at a high depth, it can be very challenging, if not impossible, to locate it. Even when the needle does intersect with the ultrasound imaging plane, it can be unclear whether it's the needle tip or whether it's a more proximal part, the needle shaft, which is visible on the ultrasound image. And this can be quite problematic because when the needle tip is lost in tissue, and this can happen both for trainees and for experienced clinicians, it can go on to puncture a critical structure such as a blood vessel. And we encounter this situation in many clinical contexts. I think in this session we saw in the first talk, vascular access highlighted. There are certainly many others. So as you're probably familiar with, there are many different methods for tracking devices in the human body, and each have advantages. We're particularly excited about ultrasonic tracking. This has the advantage of compatibility with clinical workflow and also high accuracy. And to appreciate how this works, imagine that you have not just a needle, but an ultrasound sensor inside that needle that allows you to hear transmissions from the imaging probe. So here's an example of a transmission from one element of an imaging probe. And associated with that transmission, there is a time delay, and that time delay is the time difference between onset of the transmission and reception of that transmission at the needle tip. So here's a second transmission, and here's the corresponding time delay. And I think you can appreciate from this picture that as long as the needle tip is in plane, and as long as we have more than one time delay, we should be able to identify where that needle tip is. So as a starting point, we considered this in-plane tracking paradigm, and we started with a conventional ultrasound imaging probe. This is a linear array of elements, and from each element, we transmitted a single pulse, and we received that pulse at the ultrasound sensor, which is shown here. This is the sensor inside the needle. And so with this paradigm, with 128 elements in the probe, we get a lot of timing data. And it turns out that a convenient way of processing all of these different time delays is actually to replay those signals. So to effectively consider that instead of an ultrasound sensor, we have an ultrasound source, and that source is sending these signals back towards the array. And so as a result, using time reversal, we get an image of that sensor, and this is what we call a tracking image. It's quite special because in that tracking image, there's only one object, and that's the ultrasound sensor. So the essence of ultrasonic tracking is that we have two images obtained in rapid succession. The first image is a conventional B-mode ultrasound image, which is ultrasound as the clinicians know it. And the second image is a tracking image, which tells us precisely where the device tip is. So to validate this, we used a pregnant sheep model in vivo, and our clinician collaborator inserted a needle to multiple locations. This is one location we're showing the heart of a fetus of the sheep, and she inserted the needle into the beating heart of that sheep. And you can see from the video that there's quite a high level of motion. We were interested to know, does ultrasonic tracking work in the presence of that motion? Well, here's one frame from the tracking image, and you can see that there's very high signal to noise. The signal to noise derives in part from the huge amount of averaging that's implicit in the time reversal process. And when we looked at the centroid of that tracking image object and mapped it across to the ultrasound image, you can see that there was good correspondence between that centroid and the needle tip, which happened to be quite clearly visible on this image. So this paradigm was quite promising to us. We thought that it was clinically applicable, but there was a significant limitation of this approach, namely that if the needle tip is outside of the imaging plane, we can't receive transmission, so we still don't know where the needle tip is. And as a result, to get beyond the paradigm of in-plane tracking, we needed to go beyond a conventional ultrasound imaging probe. This is such a conventional probe, and you can see that there is typically an array of ultrasound transducer elements. And on the left, you can see the side view. Each of these transducer elements transmits downwards, and it transmits through an acoustic lens, which gives rise to a relatively narrow imaging plane. This is what we want for high-resolution imaging. What we did with our study is to include additional elements. In particular, we had two side arrays on each side of the imaging array, and these side arrays, importantly, are not focused. So each side array transmits a volume that allows for us to access several centimeters on either side of the imaging plane. Here's a top view of the probe, and you can see that the imaging array has 128 elements. Each side array has 32 elements, so we've effectively only doubled the number of elements to get access to a three-dimensional volume of tissue. We call this a 1.5D probe, not to be fancy, but rather to indicate that there are far more elements in one dimension than in the other. Here's what the probe looks like. This probe was manufactured for us by a company called Vermont in France, and what the clinicians particularly appreciated about this is that it's quite compact. It has very similar dimensions to a conventional probe. There are indeed 3D ultrasound imaging probes. These happen to be very practical for many areas of the body where space is limited. They also wanted to maintain the high image resolution. So we can see, just schematically, this is where the imaging arrays are. In the case of our custom probe, we have two tracking arrays on either side. And not shown here, more proximal, is an electronic switch which allowed us to alternate rapidly between the imaging array and the tracking array. And that's important for us because this probe was connected to a commercial ultrasound imaging system which was only able to access 128 elements at a time. So we didn't have to redesign the scanner for this. In this schematic, you can see the ultrasound probe, and you can see it connected to the scanner. And you can also see the needle, which has an integrated sensor within it. That sensor is connected to a console. The console data are acquired synchronously with transmissions from the imaging probe. And I should tell you something about the sensor. Well, if we zoom in at the needle tip, here we see a 20-gauge needle. We could certainly have used a smaller gauge needle. And you may be able to see within that needle there is something. There is an arrow pointing to a small fiber optic. I've highlighted it here. And when we zoom in, what we can see is the ultrasound sensor. This is a fiber optic sensor, and it has a polymeric coating at the distal end. On each side of the polymeric coating, so here and here, we have a mirror which effectively traps light for a while. So this cavity becomes very sensitive in its reflectance to slight deformations. And when ultrasound waves arrive, they deform the cavity ever so slightly, and those deformations are measurable with an optical reflectance measure. So the way that we estimated the needle tip position is to obtain delays from the transmissions from each of the side array elements. And what we did is to compare those measured time delays with modeled time delays. And this was a least squares minimization approach. We used a weighting factor to account for differences in signal strength. And essentially, the estimated location is the one that gave rise to the smallest difference between time delays that were measured and those that were modeled. And to increase the signal-to-noise ratio, we used a Golay encoding scheme. This is somewhat similar in spirit to when I say the word alpha. That's conveying a lot more information to you than if I simply say the first letter A. Here, instead of transmitting a single pulse, we transmit two sequences of pulses. And what's neat about this is that the sensor data can be decoded. You can effectively pulse compress it. It's well defined and obtain what looks like a single pulse, except with much higher signal to noise. We evaluated accuracy in a water bath where we could carefully control the position of the needle relative to the probe. There's very good agreement between the actual and estimated positions, and the tracking accuracy was better than 0.4 millimeters in all dimensions. And this is certainly sufficient clinically because this distance, 0.4 millimeters, is smaller than the diameter of most of the needles that they use. So for validation, we used a pregnant sheep model once again. Our clinician collaborator inserted the needle in several locations. And here you can see an insertion that was performed out of plane. So we're starting at a large depth. And we're going to withdraw that needle so that it crosses the imaging plane. And one topic of interest to our clinical collaborators is how you represent 3D tracking information on a 2D ultrasound image. And I think you can appreciate what's happening here. In the interest of time, I'll show you that. You can see if you can guess what's going on. Basically, the lateral and depth information is encoded in the center of the cross, and the width of the cross indicates how far it is out of plane. We also have color information, which is showing which side of the plane it's on. So in conclusion, we've demonstrated the first 3D ultrasonic tracking system that's performed with a 1.5D array. We've achieved out-of-plane tracking beyond 1 centimeter from the imaging plane, submillimeter tracking accuracy, and all within the framework of compatibility with clinical workflow. Thank you.
The talk is open for questions. So if there is none, maybe I can start with the first one. Quick one. I believe there's some work that instead of you're using a fiber optic hydrophone, instead they use a transmitting ultrasonic sensor at the needle tip. So basically the medical ultrasound, the transducer only becomes a receiver. How would you compare your work with that type of approach?
So I think that's definitely an interesting approach. That was at MICAI a few years ago, and I think in this work we tried to address the problem of how to achieve three-dimensional tracking with a compact probe. Previously, people have looked at transmissions or reception with a two-dimensional array probe, but effectively the physics are such that one can go in either direction.
Would there be any advantage in terms of the sterilizability or reuse of these sensors if it is a hydrophone or a transmitter?
I think it depends on how the transmissions are performed. There is optical transmission of ultrasound as well. These fiber optic hydrophones have a very small element, so they are very omnidirectional, and this makes them very attractive for this. So to achieve omnidirectionality with a transmitter, one would need quite a high pressure at the point of transmission. That would be one consideration.
Thank you. Any questions?
Very curious to know if, I guess your needle now has to have a wire coming out the back of it. I'm just curious from the workflow point of view or the clinician usability point of view, if there are any concerns about having to now have a special needle with a wire in it.
So that's a good question. The wire is in fact a fiber optic. I think that's what you're referring to. And it's very flexible. We've been working a lot with clinicians who use electrical stimulation to identify nerves, and the same paradigm applies. There are often cables emerging from needles for fluid access. So in fact, in practice, what we found is that these fiber optics are so small they can fit within the fluid channels of needles that are present already. So it hasn't really been an issue.
Thank you.
First of all, congratulations. I think really, I really like this idea of additional channels that you added. One question I had, if the tissue you are looking at is inhomogeneous in terms of the speed of sound through it, how does it, would it affect your precision, and how we can manage that?
So this is a very good question. One of the advantages of ultrasonic tracking as we see it is that there certainly can be errors introduced through inhomogeneities of the tissue, but those errors are also seen on the ultrasound B-mode image. So we think you maintain a kind of co-registration. And in fact, you could turn that problem around and use the ultrasound signals that are received perhaps to correct for some of the deformations that are experienced. And we could also imagine using that information to try to optimize the image if you know precisely where the needle tip is.
So, thank you.
So thank you very much. So thank again the speaker. There's more the next time.
Okay, so we move to the next presentation. Okay, so the title is Bioelectric Navigation, a new paradigm for intervascular device guidance, presented by Dr. Bernard Forrest from Johns Hopkins and Technische Universität zu München.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Bernard Forrest, and I'm here together with Aaron Sutton. We're the joint first authors on our paper on bioelectric navigation, which is truly a new paradigm for intervascular device guidance. I will be talking about the motivation, the buyer inspiration, and the methodology, finishing with the background and the workflow, while Aaron will be taking over and taking it from theory back to reality. Let's start with the clinical motivation. Catheter interventions are very common in the US. They're approximately 5 million each year. They're guided with fluoroscopy. Fluoroscopy is a low-dose X-ray imaging combined with injections of contrast agents to track the catheter and the guide wires while the surgeon is performing his intervention. He navigates based on a static roadmap, which he extracts from DSA and combines that with the understanding of bifurcations and the complex 3D structure, which he observed in the CTA and DSA before the intervention. The problem here is that this causes a significant amount of radiation dose, and the National Cancer Institute demanded a reduction of X-ray dose. The state of the art in catheter tracking is really to try to take digital subtraction angiography and try to show the surgeon where in his pre-op CT his catheter is currently placed, because that's actually what he's really interested in. These usually can have steps, several steps, and it's a very complicated process, starting with a CTA, then extracting the vessel segmentation, injecting the contrast agent during the intervention, performing the digital subtraction angiography, performing rigid 2D, 3D registration, motion compensation, catheter segmentation, catheter shape estimation, catheter tracking, mapping back from the DSA to the CTA, and then finally visualizing, as you can see in the video. We also heard that today, and I know at least 7 of our PhD students at our group are working on this, so this is an unsolved and very complex problem. We attempt to replace all of this, and we're going to be showing you today how we do this. But first, let me show what today's state of the art or state of care is. And this is actually still really the 2D digital subtraction angiography as you can see in this setup. We're proposing to come up with a new non-fluoroscopy localization and navigation for this catheter intervention. We identified that it's very important for surgeons to find the catheter relative to the vasculature. They don't know, or they don't need to know the global position of the catheter, but rather in which branch they are and the relative position to bifurcation, stenosis, and aneurysms. They're not affected by deformation or motion because the catheter is within the vessel, and if the vessel gets displaced or bent, they're not really very interested in that, but rather the relative position to landmarks. Our method and the novelty is that we take a smart bioelectric catheter that dynamically measures the environment in which it is. We can take this in our system and map these bioelectric time series signals back to the volumetric images. And finally, this allows us to localize the catheter with respect to the vasculature tree. Of course, this significantly reduces the demand of contrast agent and X-ray fluoroscopy, because now we can show the surgeon without this where the catheter is, and if he wants to, he still can take his update shots. This was originally inspired by a bioelectric fish. These fish generate a weak electric field around it, and they measure this change and dynamic change of the electric field along their entire body. This was presented in 1998 in the Nature paper. They can identify different kinds of material around them, volume, size of tubes. They can swim through different things even with absence of light. And this is exactly what we want to do with our catheter. So we're translating our catheter from we're translating the fish to a catheter by generating a weakly electric field using current sources. This fixes our current that we generate, so we have a static current field. We then measure the voltage U around the on several electrodes along the catheter, and from that we can easily compute the electrical impedance of the volume. We also know that the electrical impedance inversely correlates with the vessel cross-sectional area. The blood here acts as a conductor. The vessel wall has a significantly higher electric resistance and is basically our boundary. What will this look like? Here on the right side, you see a video image of us inserting a catheter in a phantom. Up in the middle, you see the signals that we acquire, and we can do a live mapping of where we expect the catheter to be in the CT image on the left. So there's a little dot moving up and down. Let me walk you through the workflow. The workflow is first we take diagnostic imaging, for example, CTA, MRI, or angiography. We perform vessel segmentation and geometry extraction. During the intervention itself, we have a smart catheter that allows us to emit and acquire our bioelectric signals. And we do a massive amount of filtering and post-processing to get a useful signal, which we then can map back to our vessel geometry using our signal registration algorithm. And finally, we could theoretically visualize the tip of the catheter relative to our preoperative CT. Going from theory to the actual execution, I'm going to hand over to Erin, please. Thank you.
So here's the experimental setup that we use to validate our system. And here's how the bioelectric signals are generated and measured. So we have a function generator and a constant current source. They send a small safe current to an electrode on our catheter. The catheter itself is a commercially available electrophysiology catheter used in cardiac procedures. So we measure the voltage between electrodes, which fluctuates based on the geometry of the vessel, like Ben mentioned. Through a standard connector, the signal travels to an amplifier and data acquisition system. So I just want to emphasize that in this case, both the source of the electric field and the detector electrodes are located on the catheter itself. This distinguishes our system from other EM and electric field mapping technology. So during the procedure, we perform a windowed DFT of the signal from the electrodes and consider only the magnitude at the input frequency for each time step. That's the bottom blue plot that you see in the bottom right corner. So because we take, that filters out the interference from other electric sources in the environment. Then we take the inverse of that voltage because, as Ben explains, the value is proportional to the cross-sectional area of the vessel lumen. So as you can see, bifurcations and aneurysms, represented by a pink star, an example, cause increases in inverse voltage, and stenoses, like the one represented by the blue star, cause sharp decreases in inverse voltage. So the goal is to use this bottom signal to identify the catheter's place in the vessel tree. In order to do this, we need a set of reference signals that we would expect from each possible path of our phantom in this case. Given a complex vessel tree like those in the human body, we can use the fact that cross-sectional area is directly proportional to the inverse of the voltage. So from segmented CT or CAD models, we measure the cross-sectional area along the center line of each possible path. That generates a set of labeled reference signals, one for each path. The top plot shows two examples from this phantom. So now we take our test signal and attempt to match it to each of the reference signals. From visual inspection, we can see the signals appear correlated, but are warped and misaligned in time, which makes classification difficult. The algorithm we're currently using to perform a warping to warp the signals is open-ended dynamic time warping. It warps the experimental data to best match each possible reference, then selects the reference signal with the lowest cost as the estimate. So you can see here in the bottom plot, there is an extra bifurcation in the reference signal. The extra bifurcation means that the warping has a higher cost for that signal than the top reference signal, so the algorithm selects the top reference as the most likely path taken by the catheter in that experiment. We completed a systematic study using six possible reference paths in a phantom, and the algorithm successfully identified the path taken in 46 out of 50 of the trials. Additionally, misclassified trials had higher costs, a fact that could be used later to prompt an X-ray acquisition to correct our estimate. I didn't specify before, but because the algorithm is open-ended, it performs the matching as the catheter travels through the phantom. So as we watch the catheter travel through the phantom, having detected three bifurcations, the algorithm now disqualifies the green path, leaving two possibilities. When the catheter moves past moves into the small vessel rather than passing it, the algorithm disqualifies the black path. So at the end, you can see that the system recognizes the pink path, even though the signals are slightly misaligned. The magnitude of the bioelectric signal depends on the impedance difference between tissues, and that difference, the difference between blood and vessel wall is smaller than that between saline and acrylic, so we expected smaller amplitude signals in vivo. To test this effect, we first validated the catheter and navigation algorithm in ex vivo biological tissue, and those results can be found in the proceedings. However, since then, we conducted our first experiments in a live animal, so I'm going to present those results today. The goal of this set of experiments was to see if the catheter could detect the renal arteries in a live animal, in this case a pig, with flow and all the electrical noise associated with an operating room. In this case, ground truth catheter position was measured from fluoroscopic images, unlike the previous work that I showed you with transparent phantoms. For this experiment, Dr. Gottby, our clinical collaborator, advanced the catheter through the iliac artery and into the abdominal aorta until the tip was approximately 2 centimeters superior to the renal artery marker shown in the photograph. Our area of interest is relatively small, restricted to that blue box in the other figure. So here's the interventional fluoro image series overlaid with interventional angiography. The measurement electrode is marked with a pink circle. So in general, the cross-sectional area of the abdominal aorta decreases inferiorly, as you can see at the beginning. Then we notice the increase in inverse voltage at the level of the renal arteries corresponding to the increase in cross-sectional area. Here's a second trial. In this case, the catheter was pulled back from the renal artery into the abdominal aorta. Once again, we see the increase in inverse voltage reflecting the increase in cross-sectional area as the catheter moves from the small vessel to a large vessel. These experiments were instrumental in showing that the system can detect branches in biological tissue. Our next step is to perform the same systematic mapping and navigation experiments that we performed in the acrylic phantom, but this time in a live animal. So these were our first phantom and animal experiments that demonstrated the feasibility of bioelectric navigation, a bio-inspired catheter guidance technology. Bioelectric navigation could make common procedures quicker and easy to perform and offer several advantages over existing methods. First and foremost, it would radically reduce radiation exposure for the surgical team and the patient by offering non-fluoroscopic feedback. The use of a local measurement to determine the position of the catheter relative to the surrounding anatomy means that navigation is unaffected by movement of the surrounding tissue. In conclusion, the ability to integrate 3D imaging obtained prior to the procedure with real-time bioelectric measurements offers the potential for case planning, improved efficiency for achieving difficult destinations, and precision for endovascular device deployments. Thank you very much for your attention. Are there any questions?
Thank you very much for a nice, novel device presentation. And now it's open for discussion. Do you have any questions? Yes? Please.
Yes, I think this is really interesting work. My question is in terms of Cathro navigation, the problem is you hit a bifurcation and you have to choose a path. You have to know which way to go. It seems like this kind of tells you after the fact where you went. So from a navigation point of view, it seems just a little bit late. Can you comment on that?
So it's true that it doesn't make the catheter itself easier to manipulate, nor does it give you any prediction of where you might end up at a certain junction. It is an improvement on the state of the art, though, because as you currently, in order to get feedback of which vessel you ended up in, say you have a Y bifurcation, you want to know if you're in the left or the right branch. Currently, the way that you do that is you take a X-ray image to check where you are. There's no other way to figure out where you went. So we give feedback in that situation not with an X-ray image, but with our simulated X-ray image from bioelectric information. So it doesn't actually make the catheter easier to manipulate. However, it gives that extra localization feedback without the need for X-ray.
And if I may, just one other thing. So you're using an EP catheter, which makes sense. One of the things with an EP catheter is it measures EP. And so if you're trying to do a coronary procedure, for example, with this, how do you overcome the massive amount of electroactivity already around, you know, the heart?
So the way we do that currently is we have a single input frequency that we're looking at, and it's an order of magnitude either higher or lower than all of the electrical noise in the operating room. So that's how we isolate it.
So next.
Thank you. I think this is really exciting work. I'm just wondering, because you're introducing energy in your catheter, is there any heat effect? And if there isn't heat, does the fact that you're introducing fields have any possible adverse effects on the cells in the blood?
Yes, we introduce that. No, we do not cause heat. We're at about 18 nanoamps, which is far lower than any signal that would be generated by a muscle, for instance. So our signal is lower than muscle at a higher frequency. It's not disrupting anything. And because it's at this high frequency, we can isolate it really easily and then measure it. So it doesn't interfere with the body, and it didn't interfere with our animals either.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So very quick question, please.
You partly answered by specifying the current, but I was wondering about effects like electrolysis, microbubbles, electrolyte deposits, and this kind of stuff. I suppose that with nanoamperes, it's not a major issue.
Yes, we didn't notice any negative effects. For instance, we also were careful to look for vasospasm when we were doing our in vivo study to see if at the currents that we were using, if we noticed any vasospasm, for instance, and we didn't see any effects.
Thank you.
Okay, so time is now up, and thank you very much for your nice presentation. You. Okay, so we like to move the final oral presentation today at this conference, and the title is Registration-Free Simultaneous Cartridge and Environment Modeling, presented by Liang Cao. So please start.
Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. This is Liang from the Hamlin Center for Robotic Surgery at Imperial College London. So our work is about registration-free simultaneous catheter and environment modeling. So at the beginning, I'll show you an animation about the transcatheter aortic valve replacement. So the procedure is to put the catheter all the way through the aorta to the valve and place the replaced valve there. So the guidance is very important since the catheter tip needs to avoid against the vessel wall, and we only have one chance to open the valve. So the traditional way for the guidance is to use X-ray fluoroscopy. But we can see it's still really hard to distinguish the vessel wall in the fluoroscopy, and the X-ray radiation is really harmful for both the patient and the surgeon. And the alternative way is to use intravascular ultrasound, which can provide a cross-section of the vessel wall And the electromagnetic tracking system, which can provide a sixth of pulse of the EM sensor in the coordinate frame of the field generator. So a simultaneous catheter and environment modeling method was proposed based on the fusion of IVUS and EM sensing. So the idea is to first extract the contour from the IVUS image and use the pulse reported from the EM sensor to transform the contour from the IVUS coordinate frame to the global coordinate frame to do the 3D reconstruction. But the problem is that both the measurements from the IVUS and the EM are considered as exact in this case. So which means any error from either IVUS or EM will be directly transferred to the 3D reconstruction. So to deal with this, a robust and real-time scan plus method was proposed by considering both the IVUS and the EM as observations with uncertainties. And it also takes use of the vessel morphology information from the preoperative data. The scan plus is accurate with about 0.3 to 0.4 millimeters accuracy for the vessel reconstruction. And it is also real-time with about 2 milliseconds per frame. And it is also robust to extremely abrupt cast motion as shown in the sample. So scan plus is robust, real-time, and accurate. But the only issue is that because both the EM and the preoperative data are used in the method, so the relative transformation between the EM coordinate frame and the CT coordinate frame need to be provided in the algorithm. So what people always do is to use CT markers. But the EM CT registration obtained by the CT markers may not be very accurate in the real case. And if the patient or the EM field generator moved, the EM CT registration will not be valid anymore. So in this paper, we propose a real-time 3D vessel reconstruction method for the endovascular navigation, but do not require a pre-EM CT registration. So the proposed registration-free scan is formulated as a nonlinear optimization problem, and in the objective function, the first term tried to minimize the difference between the contour extracted from the IVUS image and the contour calculated from the preoperative data, and weighted by the uncertainty of the IVUS contour. And the uncertainty of the IVUS contour can be estimated from the high reflections in the IVUS image. And the second term in the object function tried to minimize the difference between the pulse reported from the EM sensor and the catheter pulse in the step vector, and also weighted by the uncertainty of the EM data. And the third term tries to minimize the difference between the pulse reported from the anchored EM sensor and the anchor pulse in the step vector. Here, we use an anchored EM sensor to only deal with the global motion, and we assume the relative pulse between the anchor sensor and the vessel does not change. And the last term in the object function is to minimize the difference between the EM CT registration at the current frame in the step vector and the optimal solution of the EM CT registration from the previous frame, and also weighted by the corresponding uncertainty calculated from the previous frame. So to solve the optimization, here we use a real-time approximation by multiplying the transfer of all the three rotation metrics on the first term of the objective function. And by doing this approximation, both the objective function and the Jacobian can be pre-calculated on the preoperative data. So which means there is nearly no computational cost when solve the nonlinear optimization problem to make it real time. And we also prove that the approximated problem is equivalent to the original one if the coherence metrics of the IVUS counter is spherical. So after the optimal solution of the catheter pose and the anchored pose and the EM CT registration are obtained, the true complement is used to calculate the corresponding covariance matrices. So by using the true complement, The information from both IVAS and EM in the current frame will be transferred and accumulated in the covariance metrics of the EM city registration. So which means all the information from the first frame to the current frame will be summarized in this covariance metrics and will be used as an integrated observation in the next frame, which make it registration free. So how can this be registration free? And here we give an example about the Jacobian and information metrics calculated from a set of IVAS images and EM data. So as we can see, the EMCT registration is fully correlated with all the other cluster poses in the information metrics and the covariance metrics. So which means there is information about the EMCT registration from the IVAS EM together with the preoperative data. And in this paper, we online update this EMCT registration, but without losing any information. So for the experiments, first, the Monte Carlo simulation is used to assess the robustness and accuracy of the proposed algorithm. So as we can see from the figures, even large noises is added to the observation. The error of the EMCT registration reduced quite fast, and the results of the vessel reconstruction and cluster poses are still very accurate. And here is the video of the simulation and showing the 3D vessel reconstruction together with the estimation of the EMCT registration. So we can see, as more parts of the vessel were observed, the EMCT registration becomes more and more accurate, and the corresponding uncertainty converge quite fast. And for the phantom experiments, first, a hard print phantom is used in a static case to compare the proposed algorithm to the scan and the scan plus methods. And here, there are three different setups, with each setup five experiments. And from the results, we can see the proposed algorithm can achieve nearly the same accuracy comparing to scan plus, but without doing any pre-EM EMCT registration. And then another silicon phantom is used together with the pump to simulate the global motion and the periodic deformation. So here's the result with the case of the global motion. So as we can see clearly about the global motion from the result of the scan, and in this case, the proposed algorithm is robust to global motion and the result, and the result is still accurate, And then the periodic deformation and the global motion together with the periodic deformation are also simulated, and the proposed algorithm can achieve about 0.45 accuracy in different cases. And here is the left demo. So we first use a periodic pump to simulate the cardiac motion. And we just put the EM field generator there without doing any pre-EMCT registration, and the algorithm works. And then we move the field generator to another place to simulate the global motion. And our algorithm still works well. And even we moved EM field generator like this, it's still robust to this kind of case. Okay, so at last, the in vivo experiments in a swine model is also performed to validate the proposed algorithm. So as shown in this figure, the EMCT registration calculated from seven CT markers has large error, and there is global motion between different pullbacks. Well, the proposed algorithm is still robust in this case and can achieve about 0.7 to 0.8 millimeters accuracy, which is much better than the scan and the scan plus methods. So in summary, This paper proposed a intraoperative real-time 3D vessel reconstruction and cluster navigation method. So the method do not require a pre-registration between the EM quantum frame and the city quantum frame. So which means it can be easily integrated without interrupting the clinical workflow. So the proposed algorithm can also deal with global motion and periodic deformation, and it can run in real time with about 200 frames per second. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your nice results and nice presentation. So now it's open for discussion. So questions from the audience? Please. Ah, yes.
Thanks for the talk. And from my understanding, it seems that it's some method to reconstruct the a 3D versal for, and it's reconstructing adaptively a long time. So my question is, how can you avoid the local minimum solution? And also, if there's local minimum solution, how can you avoid the drift? So it's like, for your result, it's like as more frames coming, the reconstruction is very stable. So I'm just a little confused about this.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your question. You make a very good question because we are using the nonlinear optimization, and the local minimum is a very big issue for that. So in our case, suppose you have a tube, and you can only get a cross-section of that tube, which means in that case, you will have local minimum. And it's not the case in the aorta, but it may be another case. It may be happened in some place. So here, we use the EM sensor to avoid the local minimum. We test that, and when we use the EM sensor, for example, if you lose the signal from the IVUS, from the IVUS image, you will directly report this catheter pose as the EM sensor. So which, by using the EM sensor, the local minimal problem is solved.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks.
Okay, any other questions from the audience? Actually, let me the frame rate of the IBUS itself and the frame rate of the IBUS.
Okay, so right now we got a signal. It's a video signal from the IBUS tower, and we can. So right now we use free grabber to grab the images from the IBUS tower. So right now we use 30 frames per second.
Okay.
For the real demo. Yeah.
Very good. Another questions? Okay. So the time is over. Thank you very much for your nice presentation.
So thanks again to all the speakers. This concludes the last oral session of MIKAI 2016. And after the coffee break, we'll be back here at 4 for the closing ceremony. Thank you.